Hi everyone, I'm Carlotta Stacchini, a PhD student from Sapienza University of Rome, in collaboration with the Rome Anti-Doping Laboratory. I'm here to present my research project concerning the possibility of including IGF-1 as a new parameter in the athlete's biological passport. IGF-1 is a peptide hormone with anabolic effect, always prohibited both in competition and out of competition. In fact, it is present in the section 2 of the WADA prohibited list with its analogs. Physiologically, it is mainly synthesized in liver under GH stimulation, and it is used as one of the indirect markers of GH abuse. To date, it is not possible for the anti-doping lab to detect the abuse of IGF-1, because considering the molecular structure, it is not possible to discriminate between the endogenous and the exogenous origin. In these cases, it is possible either to define thresholds based on population values, or, as in the case of the parameters of the athlete's biological passport, to define individual normal ranges. In the case of IGF-1, it is not possible to define reliable thresholds considering the great inter-individual variability, so the aim of my study is to assess individual fluctuations of IGF-1 in order to consider its inclusion in the endocrinological module of the athlete's biological passport. Indeed, the detection of possible alterations in IGF-1 levels could indicate the illicit intake of drugs or supplements containing IGF-1. To this end, we have evaluated the individual profiles of male and female volunteers of different ages. And we have used capillary blood samples that were collected with a personal lensing device, from which plasma was then obtained by centrifugation. In particular, we prefer to use capillary plasma instead of, for example, dried matrix spots, in order to avoid the paper extraction step and the difficulties related to the separation of plasma from the filter papers, and also to bypass the problem of hematocrit differences. The use of this kind of matrix could allow also an increase in the number of samples and therefore an easier definition of some parameters that could be useful for the characterization of a longitudinal profile and a decrease in cost comparing with the traditional venous sampling. I've reported the specification of the sample pretreatment and the instrumental conditions. We have used 20 microliters of capillary plasma samples that were analyzed with a bottom-up approach by liquid chromatography coupled to mass spectrometry. We have also carried out stability studies in order to verify the stability of samples as whole blood up to 72 hours at 4 degrees, considering both the necessary transport phase of the samples and also the possibility of using these samples for the analysis for the evaluation of other hematological parameters, and also the long-term stability at minus 20 and minus 80 degrees as plasma samples up to 3 months, that is the time established for the storage of blood samples. As a first result of the study, I've reported the parameters considered for the validation of the method in capillary plasma. In particular, the limit of identification is 25 nanograms per milliliter, the limit of quantification is 50 nanograms per milliliter, and the method resulted linear in the range between 50 and 1000 nanograms per milliliter. In addition, the table shows the inter- and intraday repeatability values, and obviously the difference between IGF-1 T1 and IGF-1 T2 is acceptable according to the WADA requirements. Regarding the stability studies, as we can see, IGF-1 levels are stable up to 72 hours at 4 degrees and for 3 months at minus 20 and minus 80 degrees. After the validation of the method, we have used the protocol to analyze the IGF-1 profile of several volunteers. In particular, we here reported the circadian profile of two male volunteers and two female volunteers of different ages. In particular, the volunteer number 4 has type 1 diabetes. For all the volunteers, the samples were collected 3 times a day in a time range from 2 to 5 days. And as we can see from the table, the CV percent is never higher than 15, and the range of normality was calculated as the mean plus and minus 3 times the standard deviation. In particular, between the two female volunteers, there is a significant difference in the normal range, despite the age is comparable, and this is likely related to the type 1 diabetes. For illustrative purpose, I've also reported the longitudinal profile of the volunteer 3, and in this case, the samples were collected once a week for 11 weeks, and the range of normality for the longitudinal profile is practically the same to the circadian profile. So, in conclusion, we can therefore say that the method for detecting IGF-1 in capillary plasma is specific, linear, sensitive, repeatable, and doesn't present carryover. The stability studies have shown that whole blood can be stored up to 72 hours at 4 degrees, and plasma samples can be stored at minus 20 and minus 80 degrees for up to 3 months. And from the results obtained after the analysis of the samples of the volunteers, we have shown that it is possible to establish individual normal ranges for plasma IGF-1 levels, and therefore the inclusion of IGF-1 in the ABP could be a tool for the detection of IGF-1 abuse. Obviously, we have also considered some confounding factors that could alter IGF-1 levels, such as GH intake. In fact, in the case of abnormal fluctuations, the other biomarkers identified for GH abuse will of course be sought. Moreover, IGF-1 analogs, if present in the sample, could interfere with the two peptide after the analysis following a bottom-up approach, but is possible to discriminate the analogs from IGF-1 thanks to the difference in the T1 peptides. So, thank you for your kind attention. Bye.